I think I agree with two of the earlier speakers that there is no doubt that it's a historic achievement. And at the same time, if you look at it, this treaty, I think its importance is much more than the legal importance, but it's politically this treaty is important because it brings in a way some kind of credibility to the IP framework by showing that it can address the concerns of people or as if people matters. So that way this this treaty has importance. It showed for the first time after the relentless march of TRIPS agreement, for the first time there was an effort to address legally. Of course, we can recall the TRIPS, Doha Declaration on TRIPS and Public Health, but end of the day that was a declaration. This is for the first time you have a treaty which in a way try to comprehensively address the concerns of a set of people and that way to address concerns, the international obligation related to human rights and right to development. So now the question is that, it also has implications of WIPO as an institution which is in a way facing a kind of credibility crisis or credibility, not a crisis, but credibility deficit from, if you look at intellectual property rights from a public interest angle. So this way, this treaty in a way addresses to a very, very small extent, but it's a, what I would say, signaling effect. That, okay, we WIPO as an institution can address these issues. So that's why it has a signaling effect. I would say it has a signaling effect. And the question, the larger question is that, can we repeat the same spirit of flexibility concerns to a shared concern, a shared understanding to address these common concerns in other areas like medicines, food, or sustainable energy, or the environmental technologies, etc. So these are the challenges in the coming days before all of us, also WIPO as an institution. At the same time, let me now also to flag, take this opportunity to flag two more issues. As many of our colleagues pointed out, that it's a question of the challenges, the implementation. How countries are going to implement this at their domestic level, or how this treaty is going to be transformed on the ground. Whether the countries will continue or take this Marrakesh spirit and implement it in its very good intention, or may create some more kind of technical barriers because some spaces are available. I am not getting into the details. People know that there are some what you call the room for maneuvering. So I hope that countries will take the Marrakesh spirit and will not use that room in a way to create administrative and legal hassles to enjoy the work in accessible format. And lastly, this treaty also does, compared to some of the treaties which do not have a technical assistance component in it. And of course, technical assistance, when I talk about, it's in the light of the development agenda, what is mentioned, the mandate given in the development agenda to have a balanced outcome. Within that framework, this treaty does not have any mandatory provision which asks the secretary to carry out technical assistance work to implement this treaty. But I hope, I'm sure that the through various the level of cooperation and the level of concerns expressed by member state on this issue will enable us to empower the secretariat in the coming days through various mechanisms to implement a
I think the message is very clear.
Go,
there's only one chair on this panel.